to next meeting of the planning committee. My name is Stuart Kelly, I'm the chair of the committee. Could I please ask that all mobile phones are turned off or to silence? This meeting will be webcast and a record retained on the council website. The cameras are set to follow the microphones. Members, please remember to use your microphone when you are speaking. If the applicants, petitioners or agents do not wish to be filmed, please let me know before you take your seat to speak. My role is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly and in regards to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people are, to my right is the council solicitor who will give advice to the committee on procedural and legal matters that may arise, along with the minute taker and webcasters. To my left are planning officers, highway engineers and environmental health officers who will present the applications and provide any technical advice that may be required. Down the sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications and collectively make the decisions. Voting will be by a show of hands. Each application will be introduced by the planning officers. Where there is a qualifying petition of 25 signatures or more, I will invite a representative of the petitioners to address the committee for 5 minutes. I will then invite the applicants or their agents to address the committee for 5 minutes. A ward councillor can also address the committee. Once representations have been made, and following any questions or clarification committee members may have, the speaker must return to the public area and may not participate in any debate that follows within the committee. The application will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, and we will then make a decision on the application. When making decisions, members may only have regard to material planning considerations. It is a matter for each member individually to balance these considerations and to decide what weight to give them. Members will also have regard to our local planning policies and to the national planning framework and guidance. The order of tonight's agenda will be varied depending on the number of people in attendance for a specific item. The order of business, therefore, will be agenda item number 5, concerning the ship in Wallasey Village. Agenda item number 8, concerning Stoughton Hall Farm Leaving Causeway. Followed by agenda item number 6, which is Dales Way Eswell. Followed by number 7, which is Hoy Lake Presbyterian Church, Hoy Lake. We will then revert to what's left of the order 3 and 4. I've accepted an item of urgent business dealing with the subcommittee, which we will take at the end. To begin, minutes of the previous meetings have been circulated. Members happy to approve those for accuracy?
I think it's the second time now my group have asked for you to consider the day of the site visit moving from Friday. I did ask it to be minuted last time, I can't see it in the minutes anywhere. But it was raised in the planning review that you were asked to consider it. So thank you for the minutes that we've asked now a third time for the Friday to be on.
Okay, we'll make sure that that's minuted for this week's. Members content that I sign them for accuracy. Agenda item 2 then, members' code of conduct, declaration of interest. Members of the committee are asked whether they have any personal or prejudicial interest in connection with any item on the agenda, and if so, to declare them and state the nature of the interest.
Thank you.
So we start the agenda proper with the applications with agenda item number 5, the shipping BRECK ROAD WALLASEY VILLAGE. The officer will be introduced.
Thank you, Chair. This application is for the demolition of the vacant shipping and the erection of 6 houses. The application forms the approval of a similar scheme on the adjoining site for 9 houses. The current proposal matches the scale and design of the approved scheme, with front-facing gables and use of brick, venting and timber cladding. They step back from the pavement and are acceptable, an acceptable distance from neighbouring properties. One off-street parking space is provided for their dwelling, together with front and rear gardens. Overall, the proposal is considered to be suitable for this location, applying the government policy, and is therefore recommended for approval subject to the tax conditions.
Thanks for that. There's no qualified petition, so the representatives from petitioners or the applicants. There's a ward councillor present to speak to.
Yeah.
discussion about it. So, if we could pick up some of the questions you can tell us.
Brilliant, Chair. Thank you for your comments. Brick Road is a single carriageway distributor road which serves frontage residential properties on local residential side road connections. This section of Brick Road has a good casualty record, and there is no evidence of any prevailing highway safety risk involving vehicle access to and from Brick Road. The surveyed average speed are less than the posted speed limit, which is currently 30 miles per hour. The proposed site access provides visibility squares which accord with the visibility requirements set out in the guidance. As part of the proposed parking arrangements, it is proposed that the spaces will be set back 2 metres from the existing curb lines of Brick Road, thereby following the same alignment as the driveway parking for the adjacent consented scheme, as well as providing an improved pedestrian footway to the site frontage when compared to the existing limited width facility. The site is accessibly located within the urban area, accessible and well provided for by public transport and local services within Wallasey Village. Bus services on a train station are within a comfortable walking distance to the site. Take on board the decommission of the bus stops immediately on Brett Road. However, there are other stops on Wallasey Village by Cllr Ian Lewis. Development is considered to have a minor impact upon the overall level of parking within the area. There is on-street parking, which is unrestricted, further along Brick Road, and for that reason, we don't consider that it would impact unacceptably on existing highway conditions.
Clearly, the site is familiar to most members. Whether it's a five-minute report, then I think we probably all wish it would probably still continue to carry on that vein, which is commendable at a community facility and hub goes. And I think that often has some emotion attached to it. I actually have struggled to look for reasons for refusal, given our sort of commitment generally to allowing developments in residential areas. We are encouraging people to walk and cycle to public transport. The issue about a bus stop not being directly outside. I know I haven't been in a meeting at Mersey Travel today, but policy at Mersey Travel, they tried to get it within 400 yards of a bus stop. So it is an expectation that you have to make your way to a bus stop rather than the bus stop being very, very close. As I say, if we are genuinely serious about brown belt first policy, if we begin to rack up these refusals on brown belt sites, it will bring into doubt our ability to deliver on other brown belt sites. So if we build up a track record of refusals on brown belt sites that pass most of the criteria and are recommended by officers, I think we will inevitably put more pressure on other parts of the board where we might not want to develop it. It's sad that pubs are gone, but I can't really see why houses wouldn't be suitable in this particular location. At that density, townhouses are being more popular. And I find it difficult to say as a been on planning for a number of years, for reasonable reasons for refusing that would be able to be.
Thank you, Chair. To listen to the argument put by the Water Chancellor, you did mention the importance of the BRECK. Any consensus we've given already for developments to the side of this, it does encroach on the BRECK as well. I concur with the views from Councillor Foulkes. I've got to look at places like this to make sure that we're not encroaching on the BRECK, not some better places. Saying that, given the design of these particular townhouses, put into the report, they're no taller or higher than the public house that's been demolished, so I don't see it being that much of a change to the environment. I'm happy with
car park, which is an escape from the truth of that. Each of the houses in the application does have one space at least for off-street parking, so that's obviously a bonus in an area where we can see that there are a number of waiting restrictions. So it's currently a residential area with a developed use, and I can see no reason, no planning reason to recommendation. It's been duly moved and seconded that we approve it. Can I see those in favour of approval of it? And those against?
So this application seeks permission for changes to an application that was approved following an appeal for the refurbishment and reuse of stores and hall and the erection of new dwellings. The current application seeks to alter six of the approved house types, omit two of the approved house types and introduce a new house type. There would be no increase in the number of dwellings approved on the site, and the changes sought relate to amendments to the design and orientation of houses already approved. These changes will result in an improved appearance of the new dwellings and seeks to remove a number of inactive blank gables with active and more aesthetically pleasing designs. The amount of timber cladding across the dwellings has also been reduced to more sensitively reflect the red brick barn at Stourton Hill. A small increase in footprint across the whole site will result following the change of house types. The uplift would be 5.5 square metres over the whole site, which would be negligible in the context of the overall development. The conversion of Stourton Hall and the barn will remain as previously approved, as will all other aspects of the approved scheme. The vehicular access to West Hill Road is to be deleted from the scheme, with all vehicular access via Lever Causeway. Pedestrian and cycle access will be retained to West Hill Road. The changes are considered to be acceptable, with no material greater harm on the Greenbelt or the setting of the listed buildings occurring. There have been no representations received and there is no qualifying petition of objection in connection with this application. The plan that's up on the screen shows the reorientation of the dwellings within the overall context. So the bolder line is the outline of the new layout, and the shaded underneath is what was approved at appeal.
Thanks for that. There is no qualified petition. The item is removed from delegation by the ward councillor. Would the ward councillor like to address?
Yeah, thank you, Stuart. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Right, okay. First of all, I'm extremely happy that the officers have recommended this for approval in the first place, sparing in my mind, particularly emergency, but I'll come on to that later on. I've taken this out of delegation in relation to conditions 2, 9, 11 and 21. The changes proposed are harmful and also the character of the developments to such an extent that they would be harmful to the character of the Greenbelt and a listed building. By the way, Councillor Crispin and Muskrat sent an objection, but you haven't covered that again. I'm afraid of failing again. Thank you. Here again, we see developers having their cake and eating it. They win the appeal and now want many of the conditions relaxing to suit their needs. Here we have a planning system that is developer-led and is destroying the environment around us, from ancient hedgerows to trees and wildlife habitat. In my opinion, committee has to stop passing relaxation of conditions and see this move for what it is, driving the coach and horses through the planning system. Wirral Council has declared a climate emergency. This issue is a major part of the problem. You have the criteria to refuse this application. So please, could you vote accordingly? And the act in relation to the access to Restill and Redhill Road, nonsense. They're still going to access Restill and Redhill Road. Where did all that come from? Again, more misinformation from the planning department, which I'm extremely unhappy about. And that's the end of my report. Thank you.
Thanks for that. Any questions members may have for
through you, Chair. I like the word misinformation. The officer reported that there will be no vehicular access from the rest of the road. So the factuality of that, like that, we established. I think that was one of the concerns last time about the application. Yeah. Vehicles coming onto the rest of the road would be highways and difficult issues. So if anything, that's an improvement. If you've been challenged that that's not factual, I'd like you to be able to defend yourself against that accusation.
Any actual questions for the councillor? Anybody wish to ask council a question before we move into the debate? Okay, we move into the debate. Councillor Fox raises the question of the access and specifically the plans. I mean, I don't know about other members on the committee, but when we get reports, I often go online and have a look at the plans, and the plans tell me, you know, more or less what it is that I need to know so far as layouts, etc. is concerned. And I was aware at the last application that the access to West Hill Road was a point of contention, and it was a point of contention that was raised with the inspector at appeal and considered by the inspector indeed at appeal because there were some issues of right to way and covenants. And the inspector was clear that it made no difference to the inspector, that was made from the inspector. It made no difference to their determination of that appeal. Well, the only other comment I would make, because obviously there are amounts of the public, we are not revisiting the application that has been allowed on appeal. It is very much the case that the committee, refused the application on the grounds of its impact on green belts. But the developer took the appeal route and that was allowed on appeal. So whilst many of us were not happy with the developments, we did believe that the development had an impact on the green belt, we are, as they say, where we are, and that development has been allowed and stands. What we have in front of us now are a series of amendments, and the presentation that we've just heard suggests to us that the amendments being sought are such that we ought to again consider impact on the character of the hall and the green belt. Now that would be a matter for members to decide whether those changes are such that they meet the detrimental barrier because they're over and above what's already there. But we can't reconsider the whole development in that sense. Now, looking at the plans, and it's terrible to say on the screen, it strikes me, I'm bound to say, that those dwellings in closest proximity to stores and bottle are actually reduced in size and orientation to a way that it could certainly be argued would reduce the impact on the list of buildings. That was my takeaway from the plans, as well, to say that the plans don't lie on the plans. That was my takeaway from looking at the plans. The master, as I say, well, I might not be happy with the development, and it's going there. The changes that are being proposed, in my view, aren't any more harmful than the existing application. Having said that, then I'll open it to members to give their opinion.
Thank you, through you, Chair. It is very clear from the plan that's up in front of me that the vehicular access on West Hill Road will no longer be there. But as I said in my presentation, pedestrian and cycling access will still be maintained on West Hill Road.
As I said in my opening remarks, once petitioners, applicants and ward councillors have finished their presentation, you're willing to return to the public area, which certainly can take a further part in the debate. So I'm quite comfortable for you to sit there, have some rooms and listen to the debate as you sat there. But the members of the planning committee have the floor at the moment, and the rule is that we can't allow further contributions from the petitioners, Chair. Back to members.
I fully understand.
So sorry, this was going to
As I'm deputising on this, plus wasn't even the first one, but I have read up information in relation to this. The thing that really stood out with me more than anything was the just like England having no objections. Before the 11, the policy states and before in relation to archaeological sites. You do give a reason in reason 0.8. Details of a programme of archaeological work carried out in section 3.4 of Oxford Archaeology North Ex evaluation test fitting. Given the full council on Monday unanimously approved the sites of archaeological interest being taken forward in more detail, it's something that we should be proud of. Will we be having an update in relation to archaeological data in this particular area? Because this relates back to 2017.
Thank you again, Chair. There will be no change to the archaeological setting or the historical aspects of this building. The hall and the barns will remain as approved as part of the appeal, and the archaeological standing brief that was set out that remains in place as well. So there will be no additional harm to the archaeology at the site.
Thank you for that. Will we be having an update in relation to how we move that forward and also what you can carry?
Okay, that creeps into the area of planning policy. There's an item later on the agenda where we'll discuss the best way of reviewing our policies and that includes Stephen.
Notwithstanding what happened at council, I understand Jerry's anger. I understand many people's who live in that area's anger about how the application went. The whole of this committee, I think, was a unanimous decision to refuse. We have reason to be able to move the second, and I understand again when it went through on appeal. That appeal was contested. The inspector has looked at it thoroughly and has granted permission for this. As I understand from the briefing, the overall changes from this are deemed by the officers, and again, we agree on this with the officers, as being beneficial. There is some gain from it. From one of the previous concerns. I believe in its totality and the movement of the whole site, I think that the figure quotes was 5 square metres, which is the, you might think 5 square metres equivalent to what type of room?
That's more than
okay, so that, in its totality, these rejigging add up to the size of a small bedroom. Again, having already been given on appeal to refuse this at this stage, I think we'd be in some danger of not being able to justify that, given the issues that are before us. And I don't know whether they would, but the developer could.
good at being that we're acting on these reasons. Well, often when an application comes in, there are minor adjustments on site. These do seem like minor adjustments in there. So it's a healthy thing. So, you know, generally probably shoot people, you know, I can't really come up with a reason for refusing given all the evidence we have before this. But I still sense and appreciate the anger of residents about the original application. And I share some of that, but that's gone now, as you say, Jim. We are where we are.
Thanks, Chair. Councillor Foulkes makes his point eloquently as usual, and he frequently tells us that we have to consider each application, yes, on its own right and merits. So whatever happened on the previous application in the appeal, that surely is not material to how we vote on this application, because it is a new application. This is a new application.
Sorry, through you, Chair. This is a variation to conditions that were set out by the inspector on the previous appeal. So it's a Section 73 application which seeks to amend some of those conditions that relate to the approved layout on the original plan, the materials that were imposed on some of the house types. So as I said in the presentation, some of the timber cladding has to be removed and replaced with red brick, and some arrangements to the vehicle access. So it isn't a new application in itself. It's a variation to conditions that were set by the inspector at appeal. So the appeal decision is material in this instance.
just to clarify.
Steve says if there was something that could be argued in it, I would listen to that, and I've not unfortunately heard anything that's arguable as a reason for tearing this down. Now, I know the previous committee had voted unanimously, and members would be reluctant to go forward. So, on behalf of the committee, as chair, I'll move approval.
Just want to make an additional comment, and remiss me not to give Irene Williams's apologies. She's not very well, and no, Jay's had a traumatic day today, so his wife's not well, and I've not got to leave Mersey Travel today. And I just want to place on record, Jay's passion for his residents and everything that's going on. If this guy cares, you know what I mean? And he shouldn't really be here, he should be around with his missus, so I just wanted that to be registered.
I make no criticism of any council who takes the matter out of delegation, certainly one that has been as important as this and as contentious. Well, on behalf of the authority, then I'll move approval. I'll second it.
Second
move. See those in favour? Those against?
Structures. A previous retaining wall, which measured approximately 1 metre in height, had begun to bow as a result of the weight of the earth behind it. It has been replaced by a new structure consisting of gabion baskets that ranges from 1.6 metres to 2 metres in height when measured from the lower garden terrace, which provides greater structural stability than the original wall. The area behind the gabions has been backfilled. The works have been undertaken to prevent any future instability of the land and the land slippage. It's considered that the engineering and land grading works do not cause any harm to visual or neighbouring amenity, and the application is recommended for approval. There is no qualifying petition or objection.
The application is before us, taken out of delegation by Councillor Hodson. Would you like to?
The original approval elevation drawings showed a simple house the flat level ground level, as built, it extends onto formerly sloping shoulder of land above a steep valley. Members who went on the site visit last week will recall that the new house approaches challengingly close to the valley, which drops precipitously to the stream over so many metres below. They saw the evidence and the instability of the slope and the slips down the side of the valley. They will recall how the neighbouring house in Queen's Drive is set back from the valley, as was the original house on this site. The approved application indicated no groundworks or raised level, and clearly stated that most of the existing garden would be retained. By December 2018, work was in progress, but condition 4 of the original application had not been met. This required that detailed drawings be submitted to and approved by the planning authority before any work was commenced, to indicate the finished site and ground floor levels intended at the completion of the development. In relation to the existing site levels and the levels of the adjoining land, and the development shall be carried out and completed in accordance with the details so approved. In April 2018, a retrospective application was therefore made. This was approved, but even then the drawings did not address the important issue of comparison with the existing levels and levels of adjoining land. Meridian Consult, who are handling the building control requirements, have confirmed to the owners of the neighbouring house in Dalesway that they can only check that works are in accordance with what is shown on the plans, as none of the work relating to the raised levels and retaining structures was on the plans. It is clear that the work has also been carried out without building regulation approval. This very worrying, as there is no proof that the construction is even safe. As you can see from the attached photo taken by your enforcement officer, the gabions are sitting on an old garden retaining wall. This previously retained a flower bed, which along with all the other gardens along the edge of the dales, has been slowly sinking to the knowledge of neighbours for the last 42 years. What previously supported a flower bed now has the weight of 1.8 metre high gabions filled with rock, tons of stone backfilled.